This one's going to be very easy for me. This one's going to be probably my best friend during my tenure at Duke. A guy that was a great teacher, a great coach, a great educator that actually spent a lot of time with the school newspaper, putting it together. It was unbelievable the amount of time that he could give to his students and to the school. A person that spent many years here at DuPont. A gentleman that taught from 1973 to 2002 at DuPont, both in the junior senior high school. Probably, like I said, one of my best friends as an educator, Steve McFall. Steve?
Thank you, Richard. It really is a pleasure to be here with you tonight. I can't tell you how good the food was. I'm really partial to chicken and dumplings. And so, Georgia, I just want you to know that for all the meals that you've served me over the years, this one was terrific. In 1973, I came here after teaching 4 years in a small school in the middle of the state, Xenia, Illinois. My first day, I parked out in the front of the campus. I got out of my car, and as I was walking up the sidewalk, there was a kid hanging up in a tree. He seemed to be having some sort of out-of-body experience. He wouldn't come down. As I looked in the middle of the grass circle, there were two kids getting ready to fight. That had drawn a large crowd. And then I looked across in front of the gymnasium, and somebody had lit the trash can on fire. And I stood there for a minute, and I thought, where am I? About that time, the door opened, and Bill Reynolds walked out. He strolled. He wasn't in a hurry. He had three other teachers with him. He sent Jack Brohart and Sylvia Mintel to the tree to try to get the kid down. He sent Gene Petkin across campus to put the fire out in the trash can. He still wasn't upset. And he walked into the middle of the crowd and grabbed the two kids who were getting ready to fight and hauled him off to the office. At which time I said to him, I said, is there something I can do to help you? And he said, as quickly as you can, you need to get in your class and start teaching. 29 years later, as warm as that day was, the sun was out and the breeze was blowing, I was sitting in a classroom on the second floor, packing up a paper bag and a manila box. I looked out my window, and seventh hour bell had just rung, students were filing out. And the breeze was blowing, and the sun was warm, and I was in my last day of teaching. And I was reflecting back on a career that spanned 29 years in the same building. And there were things that crossed my mind. There were students that came flooding back. I remembered administrators who treated me with respect, and I respected them. How fortunate I was to have men of honor, men who sit behind me now, who guided my life and guided me as a teacher. I had colleagues, but they were more than that. They were teachers, and they became my friends, lifelong friends. And then there were the students. It wasn't enough to say that they were just students, because this was a place where you fell in love with the kids who you were teaching. How fortunate I was to be in such a place. It was a community that embraced me, and I embraced them. I can only thank you for the time that we spent together. I look here at my family's with me tonight. There are four generations of my family sitting in the front row here, including my mother, who is 90 years old. She'll kill me for telling you that. She worked as a registered nurse until she was 80. When I was going to college, I remember she gave me these words. She said, if you're going to do something in life, do something you love. She loved to be a nurse. I loved to be a teacher. My wife is a teacher. She sits here now and she understands. My daughter grew up in the bleachers over in the high school. And my grandson tonight is in college, preparing for what his life will be next. This place helped shape my life. It was my privilege to be here with you. My friend stands and introduces me, and I have to tell you that on the first day that I taught, I loved it, and I loved it.